ओम श्री साई राम। ऑफरिंग आवर हम्बल प्रणाम्स एट द लोटस फीट ऑफ आवर बिलवड मदर साई, वी बिगिन आवर टुडे सेशन। इट इज माय प्रिविलेज टू इंट्रोड्यूस यू ऑल टू माय क्लासमेट ब्रदर एन सुधींद्रन। ब्रदर सुधींद्रन जॉइंड सत्यसाई इंस्टीट्यूट ऑफ हायर लर्निंग इन द ईयर 1997 एट वृंदावन कैंपस फॉर हिज बीकॉम ऑनर्स कोर्स। He graduated from the Prashanthi Nilayam campus in the year 2002 after completing his master's in business administration. Bhagwan blessed him with the opportunity to serve as in the accounts department of Sri Sathya Sai Central Trust from 2003. While serving in the Central Trust, he was also blessed to take care of Bhagwan physically in Yajur Mandira. Brother Sudhindran was leading the Vedam chanting group in Prashanthi Nilayam Mandir during those golden years. Currently, Sudhindran is working as a senior finance manager in Andhra Pradesh MedTech zone. Many of us will be privileged to work from our homes during this current crisis, but we must applaud Sudhindran, for currently he is a frontline worker to fight the coronavirus situation in Andhra Pradesh. He is responsible for arranging all the required medical support that is required for the Andhra Pradesh state government. Today, this session is going to be different from the normal talk. It's going to be more like a conversation. I remember during our hostel days, there used to be a short time which used to be available between study hours and post our dining session. At that time, Sudhindran used to walk into the room and we all used to be around him and always curious to know what happened during the day with Swami. What were the small, small, tiny details of Swami and his interaction? We are transported back to those memory days. And I would request Siddharth Bhatt to take us down this memory lane with his conversation with Sudhindran.
Thank you, Jaideep, for setting the platform for today. We welcome Brother Sudhindran for today's session. In fact, it's a privilege to have this conversation because he's one of the few who had the rare opportunity to stay with Bhagwan in his own residence. We are all from the same batch, to be honest. We have been privileged to listen many stories. And we thought some of them which are shareable can be brought forward and something that we can learn from, how to be with Swami and what all Swami is. Observing Guru like Swami itself is a great education. So that is the idea behind today's conversation. I hope I am audible enough.
Yes, Siddharth, you are.
Okay, great. Thank you. So, to start with, brothers, Sudhir, I vaguely remember, in fact, when we joined together, the college in Vrindavan for our first year BCom, there was a time when you had no background about Swami, right? In the sense, you came fresh without any idea about who Swami was. And, that was a background, unlike many of us who actually had Swami's background, who knew what Swami is, and we were privileged to be born in Sai family. But you had a different kind of a background. And then eventually you got opportunity to understand and be close to him, know his more about Swami. So what was the tipping point, if you can narrate the instances where you got chance to be closer to him and apparently, got to know more about him?
Yeah. Thank you, brother. Sai Ram to all of you. As you mentioned rightly, when I joined Swami's university, I joined for the sole reason of getting an academic degree from Swami's college. I had absolutely no background about Swami and Swami's Leelas and Swami's institutions. My parents admitted me into the university because their colleagues mentioned to them that Satsa University trains all its students very well in academics, sports, cultural activities, and most importantly, in character building. And every Sai student who graduates from Swami's college is of a stunning character. So this is what actually inspired my parents to admit me into the college. And I was open to joining the college because my parents wanted me to study in the college. So that was the sole reason why I, you know, applied for Swami's college, and by Swami's grace, I got in. But the minute I stepped into the college hostel premises, something told me that this was not yet another college or hostel. On 31st May 1997, when I, for the first time, stepped into Vrindavan campus, and I had absolutely no idea, I had no friends there, you know, everything, everybody was totally, completely new to me. I was a complete stranger there. Just as I entered, one of the students there, my seniors, he came up to me, took the luggage from my hand, told Sairam brother, please come. And he asked me which room I was allotted. I had no idea, absolutely. So then he actually took me to the notice board and then mentioned, he asked me my name. Then he figured out which room I was allotted and then actually carried my luggage all the way to the room, kept it there and told, Sairam brother, if you need any help, please let me know. This was a culture shock of a different kind altogether. Because, you know, when anybody joins a college or hostel for the first time, one would expect the seniors to rag the juniors. But this was completely opposite and so striking that, you know, where all the students were welcoming their juniors. So that drove home the point very strongly that this was not yet another university, but this is a very special university. And like I mentioned, when I joined, I didn't know anything about Swami. And when I say anything, it implies that I was not exposed to the Leelas and Mahimas of Swami, as well to the rubbish that the media throws on Swami and his activities. So I actually came with a very, you know, clean mind, or, you know, a clean slate on which Swami, you know, Swami performed the Vidyabhyasam to me. Slowly, the hostel is such a sacred place because in that premises, generations after generations of students and teachers have soaked themselves in the love of Swami. The vibrations that you have in Swami's hostels, any of these hostels or any of Swami's education institutions, are so powerful and so transforming. When I joined, I had absolutely no idea about Swami, but slowly, when all the students and teachers started sharing their experiences with Swami, I slowly got a taste, a glimpse of who Swami is. Initially, I thought, since Swami was wearing ochre robe. I thought he is like any other sannyasi who runs, you know, institutions, education institutions. Then slowly after listening to his miracles, you know, then I thought, no, Swami is not like any other sannyasi. He must be some Siddha Purusha, some yogi. Then later, during March 1999, Swami granted me a very powerful experience that instilled the faith in my heart that Swami was Bhagwan, the Supreme Lord. So allow me to share that experience. It was during afternoon darshan in Vrindavan. Swami's, the heavenly doors of Trai Vrindavan opened. And that day I was privileged to be inside, standing inside the Trai compound. So as soon as the heavenly doors of Trai Vrindavan opened, Swami stepped out. And in the foreground from behind the trees, the gentle sunlight was falling on Swami's beautiful form. Swami's hair, Swami's face is shining, and you know, it was so brilliant. Swami slowly walked down the steps on the carpet towards the door to enter Sai Ramesh Hall. And as he was walking on the carpet, he took a diversion, went to the tulsi plant nearby, plucked a leaf from there, looked at me and asked, "Do you want this?" Immediately, I rushed to Swami and I opened my mouth, thinking Swami would probably put the tulsi leaf into my mouth. But then Swami told, "No, show me your hand." So when I stretched my hand, Swami placed the tulsi leaf on the palm. But even as he did that, I could feel that there's something heavy. Tulsi leaf isn't so heavy. It's just a leaf, right? So then when Swami took his hand away, I could see a gold coin shining on my palm. So I was totally surprised and shocked. And as I looked at Swami, Swami smiled and mentioned that this gold coin had the year of my birth inscribed on it. He asked me to keep it safely, not to show it to anyone, granted me namaskar, and then went into Sai Ramesh Hall for bhajans. So as the bhajans were progressing in Sai Ramesh Hall, curiosity got the better of me. So I went to a secluded corner of Trai compound, made sure no one was around because Swami mentioned not to show the coin to anybody. So when I went there, I took the gold coin from my pocket, examined it, admired it to my heart's content. And just as Swami mentioned, the year of my birth was inscribed on that. And on the reverse side, there was a portrait of a soldier mounted on horseback, something close to Kalki avatar, generally how it is portrayed. So after having admired the coin to my heart's content, I took a tissue paper, wrapped the gold coin safely in it, and put it in my trouser pocket. And in every few minutes, my hands would unconsciously go and just feel the coin to make sure that it is still there. I was still floating, in bliss. Meanwhile, it was time for Aarti, and Swami came back into Sai Ramesh Hall, from Sai Ramesh Hall in back to Trai Vrindavan. Even as he was walking down the carpet, He looked at me sternly. I was puzzled because just about maybe 20 to 30 minutes earlier, Swami was so happy with me. He had gifted me this gold coin. And within 20, 30 minutes, nothing unusual happened, but Swami was upset with me. So when Swami came towards me, he looked at me and told, "Hey, neen cheppan neeku evariki chupichundu cheppana kaani nen ichetappude vaadanu teachers andaru chusaru naaku ichese coin," meaning to say, "I told you not to show the coin to anybody, but even as I was giving the coin to you, the warden and all the teachers around have already seen the coin, so return the coin to me." I was crestfallen, but instructions were instructions. So then, rather reluctantly, I fished out the tissue from my trouser pocket, unwrapped it, and even as I was about to give the gold coin to Swami, I was shocked. When I looked at the tissue paper, in place of the gold coin, there was a tulsi leaf. I was stunned. I didn't know what was happening because just a few minutes earlier, I had checked and I had made sure that the coin was there. I felt it there. And in no time, it had just disappeared. And now Swami was standing right in front of me, stretching his hand and asking for the gold coin. Where am I supposed to go and find a gold coin now? Swami then looked at me, smiled, asked me to put the tulsi leaf into my mouth and proceeded to Trai Vrindavan. I was still kneeling down and looking at, I was totally dazed. I didn't know what was happening around me. Swami proceeded a few steps ahead, turned around, looked at me and told, "Papam." And he waved his hand and materialized the very same gold coin, called me, gave it to me. And again he told, "Be careful, don't show it to anyone." So this experience was, it just blew me away. In a matter of about 30 to 40 minutes, right in front of my eyes, in front of everybody who was there, tulsi leaf got transformed into gold coin. It was there with me for some time for me to admire and enjoy it. And unknowingly, it just disappeared and tulsi leaf came in its place. And yet, in a few seconds, from nowhere, the same gold coin came back and Swami gave it to me. This really shook me and made me realize that I was in the presence of the Supreme God. None else but the Supreme One. Call him whatever you want. Paramatma, Parabrahma, Rama, Krishna, Yeshu, whatever. I mean, he is all that and more. So this experience transformed my life, I would say, because it planted the seed of faith in my heart. This also, in a way, revealed to me that Swami was actually demonstrating what he was doing at a macro level, at a macro cosmic level, that he is the one who creates it. He is the creator, he is the sustainer, and he is the destroyer. Because from out of nowhere, he created the gold coin from tulsi leaf. It was there for some time, then it vanished into nowhere from wherever it came from, the source. And yet again, it got rematerialized. And this is what happens, right? We all know that God, at the start of the creation cycle, he creates everything. It's there for some time, and he enjoys the sport as his leela. And then at the time of pralaya, it all merges back into him. And yet in the next creation cycle, it emerges forth from him. The Ganapati Atharvashirsham says the very same thing. Sarvam jagadidam tvatto jayate, sarvam jagadidam tvattas tishthati, sarvam jagadidam tvayilaya meshyati, sarvam jagadidam tvayipratyeti. So this was it. Swami demonstrated the very same principle in a matter of 30 to 40 minutes. So this was a life-changing experience for me, and this made me a devotee of Bhagwan.
Very beautifully explained, brother. I think there are two very important points that for most of us we need to note, because in the past sessions also we have been seeing the questions on faith, especially in these times, when the faith is being tested. And this is where, we come to know in terms of how Swami instills the faith. And very beautifully you mentioned about all the qualities of Brahma, Vishnu, Maheshwara, creator, sustainer, destroyer, put into one. That is what Swami is all about. And the point, if I can bring out from this, is many times we feel that, Swami is physically around and miracles happen. And in this one single experience, when you mentioned that Swami actually went into Sai Ramesh Hall after giving you the gold coin, his physical presence was not around. But when he came back, it had already converted back into tulsi leaf. So it clearly shows that, Swami's physical presence is not the only thing. Today also he exists with us. He doesn't need to be around standing to have miracles. Miracles are happening today also, irrespective whether his physical form is there or not there. And he's constantly watching on us. You never know, Swami has blessed each one of us with this kind of gold coins and tulsi leaf in terms of blessings. And we need to ensure that our faith remains intact. And currently it's an examination for all of us to see, in these times, do we sustain the faith or we fall apart. So fantastic experience to start with, and this is a great tipping point. Moving on, we also understand that you had got chance to go to Kodaikanal with Bhagwan on, I think, a couple of occasions. And maybe you would like to narrate any specific experiences, because Kodai is one privilege where you live with Swami probably in the same room, or at least in the same complex, like a family member. And just being observing him in those days itself is a great learning experience. So any key learnings, key messages from that, those Kodaikanal golden days, if you can share.
Yeah. In fact, this is about the same time when Swami used to take the students to Kodai, right? Summer. Swami had blessed me to accompany him to Kodai during the years 1999 and 2007. Let me start with 1999. In fact, let me tell you how Swami informed us that, we were all chosen to be part of the Kodai group. It was, I think, mid-April, just after probably April 14th or 15th or so. And that year, Swami had gone to Kodai around April 22nd, I think it was April 22nd, 1999. Just a few days prior to that, Swami had called a few boys after morning darshan to be assembled inside the Trayi compound. Rumors were, of course, going on that, these were the students chosen to go to Kodai with Swami that year. Swami then indicated that all of us should go into the interview room, and we were all seated there. Swami came from inside the mandir, came into the interview room, He sat on his chair. He looked at all of us, took a sheet of paper from among the letters that Swami gets, a pile of letters Swami had collected from all the devotees. It was lying next to his chair. From that, he just took a piece of paper, looked at it, and started calling out names. He told, whatever, A, B. And then he took one name. He told, Calcutta boy, rowdy, bad boy, that, this. A list of complaints. And then turned to somebody. He'll look at that person. What is your name? So that guy will say his name. Yes. Bad boy, that, this. So like every name he would take, he would like list out a big, you know, list of complaints about that boy, not studying, distracted, so many. It was basically our list of whatever things that we had done that we are not supposed to be doing as Swami students, as Swami's ideal students. At the end of it, basically, all of us were on our feet, crying and pleading with Swami. Swami told all of you, you go out immediately, go back home. I don't want to see you here and all that. Then we were all crying, pleading, Swami, please forgive us. We will not do this. And all that drama was going on for almost like half an hour. We held Swami's feet and, you know, all that happened. Then finally, Swami told, okay, I'll all give you last chance. If you behave yourself well, I will take you all to Kodaikanal. He told that. And then he told, see, this letter Warden has written about all of you, it's still with me. And I can drop any of you from this list and you won't be going to Kodai with me. He told that. Then he took that and he went away into his room. So then we all came out of Trai interview room, directly went to Warden Sir's office. He was there. We told, sir, this is so unfair. How could you do this? I mean, yes, we have probably done some mistakes knowingly, unknowingly, but is this what you do to us, to all of us, that you write a list of all the complaints, some of which we did, some of which we didn't even do, to Swami? He was saying, what letter? What complaint? Who wrote? Then we all narrated all this happened. Then he laughed loudly and told, Babu, Swami has fooled all of you. I never wrote any letter to Swami. I dare not write any such letter complaining about students to Swami because you are all Swami's students. I dare not do that because I know the next second I'll be chucked out of the hostel. Swami had a very nice time fooling all of you. So that's when we realized that one or two names Swami had read out from the so-called the list. And rest of it, Swami just asked each one to, you know, tell his name. And Swami just like played on with that. He basically read out some imaginary list of names and list of complaints against each of those names. So that's how I think Swami played this, to just make sure that we know the value of going with Swami, and to drive home a point more very, very, you know, very strongly, that in spite of who you are, God knows how good you are, how bad you are, but yet God loves you unconditionally like a parent. Like it comes in Shankaracharya's shloka, that there could be possibly a bad son, but never a bad mother. So Swami drove home the point that in spite of all our limitations, all our undesirable qualities, all our bad vasanas, bad karmas, sins, whatever, but still Swami loves us and He forgives us, and He always gives us a chance to improve. so that we may change, transform, and live up to his expectation. So this was a very nice drama, humorous drama, of course, Swami had at our cost. But at the end of it, it drove home a very, very strong point. So that's how the Kodai trip began in 1999. There's yet another incident that I would like to narrate regarding the Kodai of 1999. It was Ishwarama Day on May 6th. And as always, Swami had planned for Narayan Seva, distribution of food and clothes and blanket to all the devotees in Kodaikanal. That year too, all the arrangements were all in place. And the previous day, all the elders updated Swami about what were the arrangements done, and then who was to do which task, and you know how whole thing will be executed. And the next morning also, we all got instructions, and then all of us, in all sincerity, we did it as per what was told to us. And from all that we could see, after probably 2 to 3 hours of non-stop seva, running around, fetching this, fetching that, distributing this, giving that, at the end of it all, about after probably 3 hours or so, we all came back and sat in front of Swami in the central room in Sai Shruti, Kodaikanal. We were also happy and satisfied that everybody who came into Sai Shruti that day received Swami Prasadam of food, clothes, everything. And everybody like went around and made sure that nobody was left out. We were all very happy and we all came back and sat at Swami's feet with the expectation that Swami would say, good boys, all of you did a good job and all that. But Swami was looking rather unsatisfied. There was something, he was not upset or angry, but that there was something that was bothering him. So we were all puzzled, because apparently everything went off very smoothly. There was no glitch anywhere. So what was bothering Swami? That was the question that was in all our minds. Then one of the elders made bold and asked Swami, Swami, has something gone wrong? You seem to be upset, or rather not satisfied with the whole thing that happened this morning. Then immediately all the students also ventured and asked for Swami's forgiveness. Swami, knowingly, unknowingly, have you done some mistake? Have we upset you in some way? Was there an act of indiscipline, or have we left out somebody in the distribution? Have you done something wrong, Swami? Please forgive us. Swami then told, no, nothing. You've all done a good job. No problem. And then Swami went on to say, see, today thousands of devotees, especially the poor folk, the Ridra Narayanas, have come to Sai Shruti, and they have obtained Swami's prasadam in the form of food and clothing, and they have all gone back. Good. But what about those old and poor people who cannot even walk, who cannot venture out of their house or the platform where they are living? What about them? Who will take care of them? Who will give them food? Who will give them clothing? Who will give them the blanket that they do not even have in this cold weather of Kodaikanal? So when Swami told that, we didn't have an answer to that. So then Swami instructed the elders there to load food packets and blanket into the jeep that follows Swami's car. And then Swami told, let's go. And he picked one or two of us. Swami had blessed me to accompany him also in the car. And for the next 1 or 2 hours, Swami went to each and every street and lane and by lane of Kodaikanal. Went there, spotted poor people by the roadside, lying down, with no one to care for them, stopped the car, instructed people to Sevadal to go give them the food and blanket and then come back. He went street by street that day, looking at both sides of the street and instructing, go give him, go give that lady, go give that child there. He did that for the next 2-3 hours. Went around again and again, gave food packets and clothing and warm clothes and blankets to all those people, came back into Saishruti again and then told, now I'm happy and satisfied because all my children have got prasadam. So that is the perspective of a divine mother. He doesn't see just the children around him who have received his prasadam, but in fact, his mind and his thoughts are more with those who are not with him at that point of time. Those who really deserve those blessings from him, that prasadam from him. And this shows that actually there is no limit to seva. That there is no limit to how much one can love and one can serve. There are literally no limits, no bounds. And even when we think that we have done the best we can, there's still so much more as per Swami's perspective that we can improve. So this was an eye-opener for all of us that time.
I think that there is such an important lesson in this experience is normally we see the best is always, but here it is best also can be bettered. I think Swami is leading by an example, though, and you know, he is perfection incarnate. And he doesn't, his love, you know, nobody can be left out from his all-encompassing thousand mothers' love. Again, given the current situation, there is another important lesson for us from this, that rest assured, if we are in difficult situation, Bhagwan is not happy. He will do his all his best to ensure that we are comfortable, we are happy, and we are taken care of. Such a loving Lord when he's with us, I don't think so anywhere we should be worrying that, you know, anything can be touched, because his arms are around us and we are always protected. And very beautifully you said, it's not just the immediate people, but way beyond, you know, people who are around. They are also under his protection and again care. And he will not rest till everybody is taken care of. That's a remarkable quality of such a loving avatar that we have got. Thank you very much for sharing this experience. I'm sure it is going to be etched in our heart for a long time. Going forward, I think you had one rare opportunity probably nobody else could think of in Satyasaya Avatar, is to become a charioteer of the Lord himself. All of us know that the Lord became a charioteer in Mahabharata war to Arjuna. But for the same Lord to become a charioteer is the rarest of an experience or an opportunity. So I think year 2000 sports meet was that rare event when you yourself was a charioteer to our beloved Lord. And there are many photographs on the YouTube, also on Google, people can search and see that our brother was fortunate. But that, given that special year, maybe you can narrate any important messenger or lesson or a learning or an experience in that period of sports meet of year 2000. That would be fantastic.
Yeah. It was Swami's limitless kindness and love that he gave me the opportunity of being the charioteer for the Supreme Lord. Words can never ever express the love and gratitude that I owe to him for many, many lives to come. That was a very special year for me. I was part of this chariot, the horse riding group and the chariot group for the sports meet that year. That year, I was the senior students from the Prashanthi Nilayam campus had come to Vrindavan for the practice because all the horses were there. So they had come there for the practice. And after a brief period of practice for a few days, for probably 1 or 2 weeks, all the students, Swami had asked all the Prashantrilayam campus students to come, had allowed them to come to Parthi for the Christmas celebrations. Swami had also permitted me to join them that year, though I was still studying in Vrindavan campus. So I was the only student from Vrindavan campus to accompany the Prashantinilayam campus students. And while they, when we came to Prashantinilayam, they had of course gone back to their rooms in the hostel. And since I was not from the senior boys hostel in Prashantinilayam, but from Vrindavan, I was given accommodation in the ashram until the Vrindavan boys would come and be housed in the old boys hostel, as we call it. So then warden had permitted, the warden of the Prashantinilayam hostel had permitted one of the students to drop me off from the hostel to the ashram on the hostel scooter. So this student brother of mine, so then he took me on the scooter. So I was pillion riding and he took me on the scooter from the hostel to the ashram. And midway, near, I would say just about opposite the high secondary school building, there's a speed breaker there. And then, in order to avoid the speed breaker, he came to the side of the road and then, you know, just took a light turn and then he went back to the, back onto the main road. But in the process, what happened was my feet that were dangling on either side of the scooter, the toe jammed against the milestone and it started bleeding profusely. So immediately he took me to the general hospital. Then we went and we got it dressed. And then he dropped me off at the ashram, you know, apologizing, saying, sorry, brother, I don't know how this happened. I'm extremely sorry. But of course, the fault was mine because I had left my feet dangling and I should have probably been, you know, I should have been more, you know, more safer then. But that the physical injury was just one part and the less troublesome one that I perceived to be, because in a few days from then, the sports meet was about to, you know, happen. And the sports meet practice was were going on in full swing. And I was part of this horse riding and the chariot group. And with this injured feet, I was really concerned if I would ever be a part of this sports meet at all. So, and to add to that, during those days, Swami had permitted me to come into the Purnachandra. Swami was living in the Purnachandra then, to come and be with him and to dine with him. And so then the fear struck me that if Swami saw me limping, he would ask me what happened. I would then have to narrate all this. And we know that Swami is loving God, no doubt. But as an administrator, none can be ever demanding or more disciplinarian than Swami. So as head of the Satsai institutions, Swami would be very, very, very strict and demanding from all the students and teachers. And if I have to narrate this to Swami physically what happened, I knew for sure that number one, I would get scolded badly, but I would say that's fine because that anyway was my fault. But in addition to that, probably the student brother who dropped me would get blasted, and 100 times more than all this, the warden would get scolded very badly, and probably that could even, like, you know, lead to a bigger problem, that Swami will be upset with students and not show interest in the sports meet practice. And so many things, these things just started flooding into my mind. I was like, oh God, how can I let this happen? because everybody looks, all the students and teachers look forward to sports meet because that's an opportunity for them to present something to Swami, to do something and express their love and gratitude to Swami. And if I were to become a reason or, you know, an impediment to that, I would get the curse of all the students and teachers. I was really concerned. So then I prayed to Swami and I told Swami, Swami, while I know that you know each and every bit of what happened this morning, I don't want to physically tell you this because I can't even imagine how things can go wrong. But at the same time, you are such a loving mother, more affectionate and loving than even my own physical mother. And as a child, it is but natural for me to come and tell you, and also natural for you as a mother, because you're showering that kind of love to me physically, that you demand that I tell you this. Swami, I don't want to tell you this physically, but I don't want to be guilty of the fact that I'm hiding this truth from you. So just give me an indication that you know what has happened. You are aware that you know every bit of what has happened. And I don't have to tell you, and you'll just forgive me and everybody and let things go as if nothing ever happened. So that day, after this prayer, I went into Purnachandra to join Swami for lunch. And then as I walked in, I was limping. I saw that Swami had observed that. And Swami had let it go. And after the lunch session, Swami was seated on his chair. And Swami was reading devotees' letters. As he was reading one of the letters, suddenly he looked at me with a very, very mischievous smile, a twinkle in his eye, and asked me in Telugu, Nubu, Chenchu Natakam Chusava? Meaning, have you seen the Chenchu Natakam? So let me give you a small background. This Chenchu Natakam is a form of a folk drama that is very common in the areas around Anantapur district. And it narrates, it portrays the story of Lord Narasimha and his two consorts, Adi Lakshmi and Chenchu Lakshmi. So this, apparently there was a troop that was about to visit Prashanthi Nilayam, and they had requested that they want to stage this folk drama in front of Swami. And Swami had then given instructions that it should happen in college, university, auditorium and all that. I won't get into the details. But the point is, when Swami asked me, Nu Chenchu Natakam Chusava, with a mischievous smile, only I knew that Swami was acknowledging the fact that he knew what had happened, because the student brother who dropped me that day from the hostel to the ashram, and who was probably one of the witness or a cause from injuring my toe, his nickname was Chenchu. So when Swami referred to Chenchu Natakam, he obviously referred to the episode that happened that morning that involved me, my brother, student brother Chenchu and me, the drama that happened that morning. So in a very wonderful cryptic way, Swami had conveyed the message that, don't worry, I know what happened, I forgive you, just relax. And at the same time, Swami then, once he brought about this topic, he then gave instruction to the ashram administrators to go about to arrange for staging this play in the university auditorium. So wonderfully, Swami had used this word Chenchu Natakam to convey so many different things to different people. So this demonstrated Swami's omniscience, that he knew every bit of what happened, what is happening and what will happen. And at the same time, he is so loving and so forgiving that he takes care of all very, very small prayers and, such small and silly things that happen in everybody's lives. So that is one unforgettable experience that is related to sports meet that I wanted to share with all of you.
Indeed, I think this is, you know, many times you wonder whether Swami knows. Should I remind him again and again by repeating my prayer? But here, this you know, clearly this experience is that Bhagwan is omniscient. He knows everything. He has eyes everywhere. I think one of the famous you know, Vedam stanzas is Sahasra Shirsha Purushaha Sahasraksha Sahasrapat. So, you know, he's all-knowing, all-pervasive. Again, coming back to, we can't restrict him to just 5 feet three inch form, but he's all-pervasive, all-knowing. And, you know, we have to just pray from the bottom of our heart, and that's about it. You know, he knows. I think among very many conversations that, you know, devotee and a God has, I think the private conversation which only the devotee and the Lord knows is the most beautiful. It's not that everybody should hear and, you know, what did Swami say, you know, that it doesn't have that nectarine bliss, then only what you come to know what Swami has said. So that private conversation has its own beauty. So very beautifully brought about. I think moving on, there was a time when you passed out, you know, from the college, and the transition from, you know, being a student of the university to become his student in genuine sense, his Sai student, of Bhagwan student. The transition, how was it? Because I think I remember, because being a classmate, I remember those days, you know, when in Vrindavan, you know, there was a tiff where parents wanted you to be back home and you wanted to be with Swami. And, you know, in such cases, how did you deal, you know, situation?
Yeah. So, Swami's love comes in many forms. One is, of course, the sweet form of love. Other is the spicy or the difficult form of Swami's love that is not so easy and not so convenient for all of us. When I began my student days, I had absolutely no idea of who Swami was. But when I reached the end of my, when I was approaching the second year of MBA, by then, Swami had planted the seed of faith in my heart, nurtured it with so much of abundance of his sweet love. And he had literally, you know, made that small seed sprout forth into a, you know, seedling, sapling, and then became a huge tree, flowering tree full of beautiful flowers and his sweet fruits of his love. That's when I realized that I want to spend my life with Swami, and I didn't want to go back home. So those years, for almost more than 4 years, I didn't go home. I was in the hostel. I was with Bhagwan and Swami's mandir, be it in Vrindavan or Kodai or Prashantilayam, wherever Swami was. Swami had granted me that opportunity. And then I just didn't want to go back home. But then my parents, as natural for any parent, were attached, and they were expecting that I would probably finish my BCom MBA and then go back home to be with them. But then Swami had indicated to me that he had different plans for me. And I knew that my life was to be with Swami. And then this dilemma cropped up. My parents wanted me to be with them, and I had not even gone home for like more than 4 years. Whereas my heart wanted to be with Swami. And it's the typical dilemma, because the Upanishads say, and Swami has repeated that a million times, Matru Devo Bhava, Pitru Devo Bhava, respect your parents, they are God, obey your parents and all that. But what happens when this is seemingly contrary to what you should be doing to be near God. That's when Swami had given me very good lessons and good company and good, sane, sagely advice through the teachers of Swami's college, because they had, you know, in various points in time, they had mentioned, and even Swami had mentioned in his discourses, that when there is apparently a dilemma for you between the world and God, and the world, when I refer to in a very, very loose sense, I would put even the parents there. So what to do when father says something, but you're supposed to do something else to be with Swami based on what Swami has already indicated to you? So that's when I realized that in the scriptures, while every episode emphasizes that one should respect and obey parents, there are a few episodes that are very strikingly in contrast to that. If we were to refer to the instance of Prahlada, who disobeyed his father so that he could be a devotee and worship his Lord Narayana. What about the case of Bharata, who was so attached to his brother Lord Rama, he disobeyed his mother Kaikeyi and then went with Rama to serve him. But of course, Rama had different plans for him. And yet another episode where the Guru Shukracharya instructs the King Mahabali not to promise to give any charity to the apparently innocent looking Vamana who was there, who was Vishnu incarnate. So in these three cases, the person, the protagonist, disobeyed his father, mother, and his guru, which is directly against the Matru Devo Bhava, Pitru Devo Bhava, Acharya Devo Bhava. But that was done so as to conform to the divine instructions. So this is what happened in my life too. When Swami had indicated that I should be with Swami and serve him, but Swami was very, very particular that I should not upset my parents. So then he kept telling me to go be with them and serve them, that he would still bless me and all that. But I knew that that was not how my life will be unfolding based on what Swami had indicated. So then, after I graduated from, after MBA, I was a waiting boy, so to say. As in, I had finished my studies and I was just waiting for Swami's instructions to take the next step. And my prayer was that he would give me an opportunity to serve him in the ashram, in one of his institutions. And it was November 2002 when my parents had come for Bhagwan's birthday celebrations. Swami had called us in for an interview. And in that, Swami told me that I should go home. I kept pleading to Swami, "Swami, no, I don't want to go home. I want to be with you. I want to serve you," and all that. But Swami didn't budge. He just didn't budge. Repeatedly, 10, 20 times, Swami kept telling, "I told no, Swami, I want to be with Swami," and all that. Then it came to a point where Swami told, "If you don't obey me, I will not even talk to you. I won't give you any opportunity to serve me." Then he told, "Please obey me. Make sure that you go with your parents now after birthday celebrations. Be with them. Make them happy. And then you come back. I'll give you a job in the ashram." So then, rather reluctantly, I knew that I had pushed Swami to the limits. So then I obeyed. And then I went with my parents home, spent about 3-4 days, and then came back. By then, I had also explained and conveyed to my parents that this is that I wanted to serve Swami and be with him physically and serve Swami, because that was something that is unimaginable, you know, a loss if I don't grab this opportunity that is like come my way in like millions and millions of lives. By then my parents had also agreed and they had blessed me that I should be with Swami and serve him. So at the end of it, when I came back, Swami saw me and he asked and told everybody, see, this boy didn't go home for 4 years and he's gone home and he's come back in not even 4 days time, he told. And then Swami, after about a month or two, granted me the opportunity to serve him. And let me quickly recap what happened. I was still a waiting boy. It was Shankranti Day, Jan 14, 2003. I was sitting in the portico. Swami had granted darshan in the evening and gone into the interview room. And I was thinking aloud, I was thinking to myself, saying, I had graduated, I had stepped out of the college in March 31st, 2002, and now it is Jan 14, 2003. Almost about 9 to 10 months have gone by, and soon after sports meet and Shankranti, Shivratri would come, and after that Swami would go to Vrindavan, and then Swami would return only around Guru Purnima time. So, okay, it's going to be a long wait. Just as I was thinking this in my mind, that very second, the then registrar of the university came running out of Swami's interview room and told Swami, he came to me and told Swami is calling me. So I immediately ran behind him in the interview room. Swami was seated there on his chair. Then after I went inside, Swami granted me namaskar, and then he spoke to the elders with him, Chakravarti Garu, the secretary of the trust, the vice chancellor, Dr. G. Venkatraman, and few other elders there. He pointed to me and then told them, I tested this boy for 4 years. He has passed the test. My heart is melted. Give him job immediately in the Central Trust. So then that's how Swami granted me the great blessing of serving him in the Central Trust. But one very important point to note is that Swami mentioned that he had tested me for 4 years. When I kept pondering about it, first I was confused, because generally we assume that being away from Swami is the most testing, very difficult test to pass, because you are deprived of Swami's physical presence, his love, his affection, his darshan, sparshan, sambhashan, everything that Swami bestows physically. So that I was deprived of for 2 years. And the 2 years before that, preceding that, Swami had showered so much of physical proximity and love and affection to me. So the test was not just the 2 years of being physically separate from him, but also the 2 years when I was physically so close and blessed with proximity to him. The joy of being in Swami's physical presence, as well as the grief of not having Swami's darshan, sparshan, sambhashan, both 2 plus 2, 4 years were Swami's test for me. And true, because Swami in his letter to his Sheshamaraju Garu mentions that Sukha Dukkha Mamulu Kuda Samamuga Bhavinchuchundute Bhakti Naku. The mark of devotion is to treat both Sukha and Dukkha, both joy and sorrow, with equanimity. And this is exactly what Swami had told even in Bhagavad Gita. sakadukhe same kritva labha labhau jaya jayau. To treat both happiness and sorrow with equanimity is passing Swami's test. So now, when the whole world is going through this trauma caused due to the COVID-19, we should know that this is a test. And after this would come again the sweetness of Swami's love and grace for all of us. And it is our duty as devotee of Swami to treat both sorrow and joy as Swami's prasadam and Swami's blessings for us. And to stick on, to hold on to Him, to keep this faith strong and going, and keep serving Him, knowing very well that it is a test and that He will be with us and make us pass the test.
A very, very nice, very important message that you're delivering through this experience is, when good times come, you know, we are very elated, and when the bad times come, you know, it's like we are in a different shade. But I'm reminded of one analogy which, you know, Swami regularly used to quote is, when I want to put my photograph on the rope, on the wall. So what do we do before we put a photograph on the wall? So obviously we take a nail, we hammer it into the wall, and immediately obviously we don't put the photograph, right? We try to shake it a bit to see whether it is really, you know, there properly or it is still loose. And if it is, once it is, if it is loose, then obviously we try to put it more deeper. If it is not, then we remove and keep it away. But if it is very strong and it is holding forth, then obviously the photograph is hung on that particular nail. I think this is the current time that we are seeing, that after so much of downpour of love and grace that Bhagavan has given over so many years, now is the time when he's just trying to shake every nail and see whether we are stuck to that particular wall or we are still losing them. So if we are not having that strong faith and this test is not being cleared, there is a risk that we may be kind of put across. But if we steadfast, we hold on to his feet very strongly, even in these difficult times, then we have, the victory is near. And when Swami will put his photograph on us, saying that this is the nail which has stuck and which is in faith, and it has stood the test of times, and it deserves to have my name on it. So I think very, very beautiful, very important experience and message that, you know, very relevant for this current time that we are going through. Moving on, I think you also were part of the Vedam group in Mandir. And the time when Bhagwan initiated chanting of Rudram, earlier, I think for those who may be new to the entire setup, in the initial days, Bhagwan used to have darshan music when he used to walk and give darshan in the Kulwant Hall. And then I think subsequently in early 2000, I think 3-4, when he started chanting, made Rudram chanting as actually a darshan music. And also throughout, even till today, we chant Rudram. And brother, I think you were part of that formative group in the initial time when the Rudram chanting started in Kulwant Hall. So, and you also taught Rudram per se in Kulwant Hall. So any experiences about it, and also connected to the necklace which Bhagwan materialized and explained to you the importance of it. I think that experience, if you can share, and the message behind it, will be very important.
Yes, brother. So Swami was again very kind to have granted me the opportunity of having to sit in front of the Veda Purusha and chant the Vedas right in his presence. So though Vedam was being taught and was being chanted in Swami's presence right from, you know, many, many years even before, but the practice of chanting the Veda mantras, especially Rudram Chamakam, for during his darshan, started on September 18th or 19th of 2003. And Swami had given me the opportunity to be part of the group leading the Vedam in Prashanti Mandir. And Swami would sit there for darshan, and he would be there and he would let us chant this for like hours together. 1 or 2 hours in the morning, another 2-3 hours in the evening. So we had the our eyes were filled with Swami's beautiful form and ears were filled with the divine names. And we were totally lost in divine bliss. One of those days, Swami had asked, we were chanting the Narayana Upanishad in Swami's presence. Swami had asked me to translate the Narayana Upanishad line by line in front of everybody. So at the end of it, Swami then called me. Then he waved his hand and materialized a very, very beautiful, big and exquisite necklace. Something, a design that is not so contemporary. I would probably say it's close to what we would see in mythological movies. Something not something that is very commonly seen. That kind of very, very thick, ornate and exquisite necklace. He materialized this and then he mentioned, he gave it to me, asked me to hold it and show it to everybody in Kulwant Hall. And then also he mentioned to me to speak on the mic to everybody. And he said that the mantra Om Namo Narayanaya is the essence of all the scriptures of the world. Be it any religion, any scripture, but the essence of all that was contained in this mantra Om Namo Narayanaya. And he mentioned that the power of that mantra was in this necklace. And then he mentioned that people consider Purusha and Prakriti to be different, but both were one and the same indivisible God. So he mentioned that and he asked me to share it with everybody in Kulwant Hall. And then it was, at the end of it, I knew that that necklace was not for me. I was just given the duty to show and tell, so to say. And then at the end of it was given back to Swami and Swami sent it back to wherever it came from. But the essence of this, the lesson, very, very important takeaway is that the mantra or the name of the Lord, any name of the Lord, in fact, the Narayana Upanishad itself says that the merit of chanting the mantra or the name of the Lord is equal to chanting all the Vedas. Sarva Veda Parayana Punyam Labhate. By chanting the Lord's name, one gets the merit of chanting the entire Vedas. So therefore, by chanting Swami's name or name of any God that one loves, one gets the merit of chanting the Vedas. And that's why Swami gives so much importance to Namasmarana and bhajan singing and any form of devotion that where we take the name of the Lord. So that is a very, very important experience that I wanted to share with all of you.
Oh, very aptly put. I think in these times, when Bhagwan also said, you know, in Kali Yuga, Namasmarana is the best way and the easiest way to achieve Lord Himself. And even in these times, you know, we see there are bhajans happening on this Zoom, also on Google, YouTube Live across. And it's a great opportunity that, you know, we are having. And I think we are almost close to ending today's session. Maybe you want to leave with any message post-Mahasamadhi era that we are currently in. I think there's something which Swami shared with you in Trai session in year 2000, which probably if you can share with everyone.
Yes, brother. This is a very, very powerful experience that I want to share with everybody because it is relevant not just for me, but for each and every one of us. It was during this one of the sessions in Trai Vrindavan when Swami was sitting on the jhula and some of us were around Swami and doing path seva to Swami. And then Swami looked at me all of a sudden and asked, will you give me anything that I ask for? So I was thrilled because how many would get an opportunity to give something to Swami? So I told Swami, I will give. Swami again asked, are you sure? Will you give me anything that I asked for? And Swami stretched out his hand like this. So then I told, yes, Swami, I will definitely give. And Swami asked, will you give me your life? So then the next second, I took my hand and I was about to place on Swami's palm and say, yes, Swami, I will give. When Swami withdrew his hand and told, who are you to give your life to me? Your life is already in my hands. So that was a very, very powerful statement. Exactly, who are we to give our lives to Swami, or that we claim that we are giving something to Swami? We all are already in Swami's hands. He is taking care of us. And this statement of Swami is actually what keeps me going every day. Because I know, come what may, be it joy or sorrow or anything, I know that ultimately nothing bad will happen to me because my life is already in Swami's hands. What more can I aspire for? And this is true for every one of us, because Swami has told it many times. Even once when we say to Swami that, Swami, I am yours, then forever we are His, and He will take care of us every second, every moment, every life, every birth thereafter. That is Swami's love. And for all of us, during these difficult times, let us remember that we all are safe in Swami's hands. Every one of our lives are safe in His hands. And He is guarding us, guiding us, and loving us every moment. And that's what is something that we should always remember. And we should always be grateful to Swami for that.
Absolutely. I think, incidentally, I just got a small, Swami's message from Satya Sai Speaks, Volume 31, where Swami has said, once you say, I am yours, live up to it with strong faith. Thereafter, God will take care of you at all places and under all circumstances. I'm just quoting, I don't know, I'm just showing the photograph if people are able to see. This is that exactly the quote which Bhagwan has in Volume 31 of Satya Sai Speaks. It's a very, very big assurance in these times. Under all circumstances, He will take care, provided we have faith and we surrender to Him. I think that's a very powerful message. You yourself have faced, experienced it in Trai session, and this is for all of us. You are representing the entire humanity in front of God.
Absolutely.
And that's a great message, probably we should end with. Maybe just a thought, I don't know, because we have got very lucky to witness many materializations when you were there. It will be possible to show any materialization on this call?
Sure. I have actually one thing Swami was very kind to bless me with. We can close with this experience. It was the Tamil New Year's Day, or I think it was the Vishu or the Malayali New Year's Day of 1999, when Swami had finished the program in Sai Ramesh Hall and he was walking back to Trai. And on either side of the carpet were a row of flowers and bouquets. And as he was walking, he just picked up a bud from there and kept playing with that, and he went into Trai, the Vrindavan Mandir. And all of us were following him. And after we went inside, Swami then looked at me and He just gave that to me. And that particular bud, a flower bud, got transformed into a crystal elephant. So let me show this. I don't know if it is, probably I should show it like
this. It's visible.
I don't know. Probably like this.
Oh, that's very clear. Yeah.
It's a symbol of Swami's love.
Very nice.
This is something that I wanted to. It's a small crystal elephant gift reminding me of Swami's love and Swami's protection at all times, and giving me the strength of an elephant to keep going, facing all the vicissitudes of life.
Very nice. Thank you for sharing that. I think materialization, it's a representation of Swami itself amidst us. What we will do before we end the session, there are a few questions which are appearing on the chat panel. There's one question is, what practices should we do in order to remember that Swami is with us all the time?
Just recently, I was reading an article where Swami gives a very, very practical lesson of how to remember Him every moment of one's life. Swami says, I think Swami shared it with one of our elder brothers, Sai students, that always not imagine, but realize that Swami is with you, next to you, as an invisible friend. And just like how you would share and you would keep chatting and talking to your friend who is with you all the while, you keep speaking to Swami in your mind, in your heart. And when you're doing your work, you do it. But then when you're when you want to discuss about the work or anything related to your office or personal life, anything, just keep talking to Swami within. And that will reinforce the faith that Swami is always with us. Like Swami says, intane, ventane, jantane, kantane, unnanu. That Swami is always with us, around us, in front of us, behind us, above us, at all times. So that is a very, very easy lesson that Swami Himself has given to one of our elder brothers earlier on.
Very nice. So I think this is very important, where we can visualize Swami right next to us. And there are episodes in the past where Bhagavan has said, what is inside you is and outside you is one and the same. In Swami inside you and Swami outside you is one and the same. So our visualization, our imagination right next to us, Swami being there, it really helps us to have Swami all the time. And going forward, the next question is, with Swami in Yajur Mandir, can you share one of the most best experience?
Sorry, I didn't get you, I think.
Yeah, I'll repeat it. Basically, in your as you spend time with Swami in Yajur Mandir, any experience which is most cherished one, which you may like to share?
I would say the experience of living with Swami in that physical proximity is more of Swami as more than a God, the supreme and the most powerful God. It is that of a loving and caring and affectionate parent. That was the kind of experience Swami had, you know, given to me. So, and in his very close proximity, we get to enjoy the sweetness of his physical love and affection, love of a thousand mothers, so to say. But at the same time, in glimpses, he would reveal that he is the supreme God, and he knows and he answers all our prayers. I remember it, I think it was probably Vaikunth Ekadashi day, and I was in Yajur Mandir. Swami was in the front room, and I had some time to myself, and I was chanting the Vishnu Sahasranama mantra, and this thought came in my mind that I am in the very presence of the Lord Vishnu on this auspicious day of Vaikunth Ekadashi, and I'm reciting this Vishnu Sahasranama mantra. Swami, just acknowledge my prayer in whatever way you want. And then and another silly prayer in my mind that, Swami, I'm doing this even as I'm chanting this Vishnu Sahasranama. Please wait let me complete the mantra and then you come in, because I don't want to leave this in between. I'm praying to you, but wait till I complete the mantra and then you come in. So this silly prayer was also there in my mind, along with the prayer that Swami should acknowledge. And just as I finished chanting the Vishnu Sahasranama mantra, where it says that God listens to this prayer of the devotee and he will bless and he'll reciprocate, it comes in the very end. At that second, Swami came into the room where I was there, and then Swami came and spoke something and then in some pretext granted me namaskar. So that was a very sweet gesture of how Swami acknowledged these small prayers. When thousands and thousands, millions of people are praying to him across the world, nothing is small for Swami, because each one of us, irrespective of where we are, whether we are right in his presence physically in Yajur Mandir, or we are in the farthest corner of the world, in any part of the world, be it Antarctica or across any continent, Swami responds with the same love and spontaneity to all our prayers. So this was something that, where I'm praying to the unseen God within, and then the visible form of God comes and acknowledges that prayer. This was one of those experiences.
I think, again, it reiterates that important thing that, if we pray within, this is an experience for all of us that, Swami does listen outside also. So, again, this Swami which transcends time and space, and nothing is impossible for him. Even we pray today, it is reaching that prayer to him. That gives a very strong confirmation, I think, based on this experience that we shared. There are many questions, but for want of time, maybe I'll just take one, which is a very unique question. When so much is given by Swami to us, Swami must be expecting something in return from us. Anything that you may like to share and experience where Swami would have said, what does he expect from us?
Swami has, on many occasions, multiple occasions, he has mentioned how one should be, how one should behave oneself, how one's watch, words, actions, thoughts, character, heart. So one should always watch our these things, the thought, word and deed, and make sure it's always aligned to Swami's teachings. And how we should do it across various stages in life, right? As a student or as a householder or in the office, across, as a citizen in the country. So Swami has given very, very, very clear guidelines for us to follow, and we should always endeavor to follow that. But given that we are humans, sometimes we do fail. There are imperfections in many of us in various degrees. So then there are a few challenges that we will face when we are trying to follow Swami's teachings. In fact, I remember one of those days when I was in Swami's close proximity. Swami was one day upset with me, and he was ignoring me and not talking to me. And then this happened for one or two days, and then after that he had called me for an interview. So in the interview room, as soon as I went inside and only Swami and I were there, Swami admonished me for whatever mistake that I had done. So then immediately I caught hold of Swami's hand, put it on my head and told Swami, "Swami, bless me now that I'll be a good boy forever." Swami took his hand away and told, "I can do that and make you a good boy in a second, but I will not do that. It is for you to struggle, to apply yourself, to strive and achieve that. I can give you that in a minute. I can grant that in a second, but I will not do that. your dharma is to strive and achieve that. Strive towards goodness, strive towards perfection, strive towards Godhead. So this is something that we should all remind ourselves, that our duty is to follow Swami's teachings. And in doing that, we are bound to face some challenges sometimes. But our duty is to keep going, not to get disinterested or to give up hope. Because in our evolution, in the spiritual life, which spans over millions of lives, these ups and downs are bound to happen. But the one reassurance that Swami gives is that at the end of it all of us are bound to reach the final destination, which is Him. So with that assurance, and with the assurance that Swami is with us all the time, holding our hands and guiding us, we should just keep going and strive our best at every second to follow Swami's teachings. He will take care of the rest.
Amazing. Very, very beautifully explained. I think with this, we should close the session. But before we, leave it, an important takeaway from this particular experience that you shared, brother, is I think this is the very important time for us to practice this. Because it's a time when we are in a lockdown, we are at home. There is a time to contemplate on Bhagwan's teachings and also look at, whether when we face challenges and we also go through our stresses, we are not used to being inside four walls. That is the time when we can test whether we are reaching that equanimity, we are reaching, how are we responding within ourselves. I think all the experiences you shared over the last 1 hour, 1.5 hours or so, being equanimous, being contemplating on Bhagwan all the time, I think this is a very important opportunity where we can take as a homework for today that, and also as one of you asked on the chat panel, that what can we give to Swami? This is a time when we can just test ourselves, self-audit, whether we are progressing on this path, whether we are feeling His presence, where are we falling short of? Are we not able to kind of practice it? Why we are not able to kind of practice it? Where is the impediment? And most importantly, having that strong faith that He's listening to us, He's waiting, He's giving His hand to us so that, we can get hold of His hand and He can raise us. So I think this is a homework which we carry and from this entire 1.5 hour session. Very, very grateful to you, brother, for this spending this time. And may I request Brother Jaydeep to have a closing remarks. Yeah. Sai Ram.
Wow, Sudhir, it was really, really wonderful to learn so many lessons from these small snippets that we all have experienced during our student days. I mean, the most powerful one is like, who are we to give something to our God? It is He who has brought us down and He has the control over our life. So let's end this session with nothing that we can give, but always be grateful to whatever He has given to us. And gratitude is the always most important thing that we all should be offering to Swami. So let's end the session with the gratitude and praying for Him to bless us more and more with such beautiful stories of the Lord. Jai Shankar, over to you.
Samasta loka
sukhino
bhavantu. Samasta loka sukhino bhavantu. Samasta loka sukhino bhavantu. Om shanti shanti shanti. Jai bolo Bhagwan Shri Satya Sai Baba ji ki
jai.
Sai Ram.